several weeks, especially if there's any place that we need to be, it's in the house of the Lord. Whether or not it's in person, in the comforts of your own home, you need to be in a place and posture of worship. And that's what we come here to do at First Baptist Church of East Nashville. Join us now, if you will, as our music ministry leads us in worship.
Come on, church. I want you to join in singing, Lift Him Up. Let us pray. Father God, we recognize that you're holy God. You are the creator and the sustainer of life. You are the one who sent your word to heal us, to deliver us if we would only obey. You, Holy Father, love us so much. We're so grateful this morning that you care for us, that you beseech us to cast all of our cares upon you, because you are the one who's able to hold us up. Father, we come before you this morning. We ask that you continue to hear our prayer. Feed us bread from heaven. Lead, guide us, and direct us. Protect us, Father, in these turbulent times. We ask, dear Father, that you would let your will be done. Let your kingdom come. We ask, Father, that you would remember the sick and the shedding. Remember everyone who hears this prayer. Remember anyone in their family that may be bound by addictions. We pray, dear God, that you would deliver them from whatever they feel that they cannot break free from. Let them know that you are the same God who delivered Israel from Egypt. You're still able to emancipate those who are bowed down. You can still break chains. And dear Father, we ask that you would bless this nation. Bless the Floyd family. Bless, dear God, all those who have suffered at the hand of an enemy. We ask, dear God, that you will heal our nation. Now we ask that you give us ears to hear. Bless the man of God. Bless our pastor. Help him to continue to preach heaven, period, hell, high, warning this dying world that the wages of sin is death. In Jesus' name we love you. Amen.
Amen. We thank God again on this day for all that he continues to do in and through our lives. We thank God for Reverend Jay Davis being here with us on today. We talked about Sunday school lesson this morning. He's one of the most gifted and anointed teachers of the good news that I've ever had the pleasure and honor of coming in contact with. So I'm always blessed to be in his class when he's facilitating. And so we thank God for him, even for his testimony. It's his testimony, and I won't get into all of that, but we just thank God for all that he has done down through the years through Reverend Davis's life and continues to do as well. We had a great official board meeting on yesterday. It's an opportunity once a month where the pastor and the lay leadership of the church, the deacons and trustees are able to gather together. We did it yet again in a virtual situation. But the good news is that Jesus is still favoring First Baptist in a very, very significant way. I won't get into all of the details, but I'll just say our membership, which is a mature membership, and I'm not talking about chronologically, even though we have some maturity from that perspective as well, but our membership has learned the importance of giving to God, not because God needs it, but because God has demanded it from us. And so our membership operates with a great level of obedience to God's word as it relates to giving. And so yet again, we're moving forward in the ways that God would have us and in the ways that God has continued to equip us to. Certain things are happening here at the church. We've already stated our sanctuary is just about 100% complete. We have about 5 windows that need to be replaced, and those are being scheduled. And then our sanctuary will just be excited. There's some other things that we're in meditation and conversation about to just enhance what we do here from a worship standpoint in First Baptist Church of East Nashville. There are some other things that God is preparing to do. There's a home that was donated to our church many years ago before I ever came on the scene here as pastor. They has sit there as God has continued to work with us and through us in how to use and how to be a blessing with the home here in this community. As a matter of fact, it's my understanding that the first African-American fire chief in the city of Nashville resided in that home at one point. It's on the historic registry as well, where God has set
the roof is going to be repaired. Won't get into all of the details about it, but it's a blessing that that's going to happen. We're looking at the windows being repaired in that house as well. And what that saying to us is that God still has reason and purpose for us to be here at the corner of 6th and Main. We believe that God has restored, kind of held back, rather, the best that he wants to do in and through First Baptist Church of East Nashville for such a time as this, that this community will continue to be blessed in even greater ways with what God is continuing to do in the life of this church. So we ask that you continue to be in prayer with us, continue to operate in obedience to not only position First Baptist to be a blessing, but that you may be blessed by God as well. And that is through giving up of the tithe and the offering. God has declared in his word, bring all the tithe and offering into the storehouse and prove me now herewith and see if I won't open up the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing you won't have room to receive. And so we continue to operate in that way and are just thankful to God.
Amen.
As we all know, beginning in March, God called home several significant members of our church, beginning with Sister Benton, who was our church clerk for a number of years, and moving on to Reverend William Dotson, who was a mainstay here at First Baptist Church, and then to young brother David Webb. His father, former pastor of the church, brought by a letter, and I just want to make this statement so that folk will fully understand how I operate. Before I prepare to go into worship, I don't read anything that comes my way. My mind is focused on the matter at hand, and that is to worship God in spirit and in truth. I don't want anything that distracts me, even brings distraught on me. And rather than to guess and wonder what it may be, I just reserve the right as pastor to deal with it after worship and then deal with it on the next Sunday. And so this letter is a great letter from the Webb family, in particular from Reverend Ronald Webb. And I'm going to read it for our hearing on today. It's a letter of appreciation. Dear First Baptist Church family, on the behalf of the family of the late David Murphy Harris Webb, I would like to express our sincere gratitude for every act of grace and kindness that has been extended to us over the past 2 weeks. Each prayer, phone call, card, meal, text message, flower, and visit incrementally made our burden of grief lighter and brought us closer to the better days that lie ahead. As the sun creeps over the eastern horizon at the dawning of a new day, so has your love and support illuminated our hearts as we embark upon the first steps of our new reality. Please remember this. Some things we get over, some things we go through, but there are some things that stay with us, and our God gives us strength to live with what we can't get over or go through. Warmest regards, Ronald B. Webb, Jr. And again, we thank God for that family and what they continue even to mean in the life and even the legacy of First Baptist Church of East Nashville. Okay, and now we've arrived at the point of our worship where if we were face to face, we'd be fellowshipping, shaking hands, high-fiving, fist bumping, and all that sort of thing. As we know, we're living in a day and time because in spite of all the civil unrest, so to speak, that is going on right now, coronavirus, COVID-19, still exists. There's still not a vaccine for it. There's still not a cure for it. And so God has given us wisdom, even as our lesson talked about on today. God has given us wisdom to act appropriately on the knowledge that we have. And so as we are worshiping here virtually, we're looking at a beautiful sanctuary that doesn't have any persons in the seat. We ask that you, as our choir, as our music ministry prepares to lead us with song, we ask that you fellowship with those persons in your home. If you need to send a text message to somebody, tell them God loves them and you do too, and tell them that First Baptist Church of East Nashville is live on Facebook, and why don't they join us? I'm turning it over now to our music ministry to lead us in that very thing, the praises of God. Amen.
Thank you.
comforter. God will be your best friend. God will be your burden bearer and your heavy load sharer. That's the way the Saints of old used to put it. God is everything you will ever need. I'm glad that I learned as a little boy that if you don't know which way to turn, the only way you need to turn is to God. You don't need to go to check cashing stores. You don't need to call a sugar daddy or sugar mama. You just need to call on our Heavenly Father for everything that you need. You don't have to borrow money from this person. Just be obedient to God and watch Him supply your every need. God is a good God and greatly to be praised. Yes, sir. God is all of that in a bag of trip chips and some dip. With a soda on the side, God is all of that. And I'm glad He gives us the opportunity to worship Him in spirit and in truth. Amen. I thank God for all the persons that have participated in worship with us on the day. Reverend Davis, for sharing with us. I thank God for this wonderful music ministry we have. Y'all some of the best voices that I know for sure that the city of Nashville has ever encountered. And I would just believe if we line you up against persons all over this world, ain't nobody praising God better than you are. I'm just believing that. Amen. God is a good God. I'm glad He brought me the First Baptist for such a time as this. Mm-hmm. That makes me know that God loves me. I could be anywhere doing anything, but God called and created me to be here. And I'm thankful. Turn with me, if you will, to the book of Judges. I had Reverend Davis share with us from Judges chapter 2, verses 11 through 16, to kind of lay the backdrop, to paint the picture, so to speak, as it relates to Judges. Before I read the text, I just want to kind of give you an idea. I don't know how many folk are movie buffs who go to the movies from time to time. There's an actor by the name of Sylvester Stallone who played in a movie called Judge Dredd. He played in a movie called Judge Dredd. And y'all probably remember him from the Rocky series of movies and then First Blood series of movies. Down through the years, but Judge Dredd was really based upon what the judges that God called were responsible for doing, and that was not only protecting but passing judgment, immediate and swift judgment when they came upon situations and circumstances. And so our text today, the third chapter of Judges, verse 31, and this is the only verse that speaks of this particular judge, but it's packed with a lot of stuff that I believe God wants to share with us on today. And so here we have in Judges chapter 3, verse 31, it says, After him was Shamgar, the son of Anath, who killed 600 men of the Philistines with an ox goad, and he also delivered Israel. We're going to talk for just a few moments on this morning from the subject. It's not much, but it's all I've got. It's not much, but it's all I have. To just use correct grammar with that thing on the day. Amen. Yeah, yeah. Have you ever noticed how effective the enemy is at convincing the people of God to focus on the negative instead of the positive? Satan, the enemy, has convinced the people of God that they cannot do anything. We watched bad situations in our communities and did nothing. We watched bad situations in our schools and did nothing. We watched terrible situations in our homes and did nothing. We watched crazy situations from an orange clown in the White House and our government and did nothing. Satan has convinced the people of God that we cannot make a difference. He's convinced us that we cannot make a real change. For as long as Africans in America have been in these United States, we have suffered at the hand, foot, gun, the bat, fire hose, dogs, and noose, and most effectively, the mouth of white people. The devil has used white people as the oppression they have and the oppression they have exerted to cause physically strong men and women to walk around with their heads low, their shoulders slumped, and eyes diverted in an attempt to just live one more day. The devil has convinced Africans in America that they have no power to affect and affect change. We watched the death of Eric Garner at 43. He died on July 17th of 2014 after a police officer in Staten Island, New York, placed him in an illegal chokehold during an encounter on the sidewalk where the police said Garner was selling illegal cigarettes. I hope somebody heard that clear today. He was choked out because of some cigarettes. We watched Tamir Rice at age 12 be shot and killed in a park in Cleveland on November the 22nd in 2014. An officer by the name of Timothy Lohman and Frank Garnback responded to a call about a black male sitting on a swing and pointing a gun at people in a city park. The caller expressed doubts about the gun's authenticity. Now, hear me clearly. The caller expressed doubts about the gun's authenticity and said the male was probably a child, but that information wasn't relayed to the responding officers. Within 2 seconds of arriving at the scene, Lohman fired 2 shots, one hitting Rice in the belly. Rice's weapon later was found to be a black toy gun. And then in December 2015, the grand jury declined to indict Lohman or Garnback. Then Michael Brown Jr., who was 18 years old, a black teenager who was gunned down by a white police officer in Ferguson, Missouri. That officer, Darren Wilson, responded to a reported robbery and encountered Brown and his friend Dorian Johnson walking down the road. Wilson blocked the two with his police car, and after a reported struggle ensued through a window, Officer Wilson fired his gun and followed Brown after Brown said, "I'm going to turn tail and run." When Brown stopped to face the officer, Wilson fired several shots in his front and killed him. And the Department of Justice there in that state cleared Wilson of civil rights violations in March of 2015, and the church did nothing. Fred Gray, 25, was killed in Baltimore as 6 officers only faced charges of misconduct and possibly second-degree murder for what they did in April of 2015. The report says Gray died when his neck was broken in the back of a police transport van. He had been restrained with handcuffs and leg irons, but not a seatbelt. The involuntary manslaughter trial of the first of those charged, William Porter, ended in a hung jury. And we did nothing. Sandra Bland, a 28-year-old African-American woman, was found hanged in her jail cell in Walter County, Texas, on July 13th of 2015. 3 days prior, she was arrested and assaulted during a traffic stop.
Yeah.
In a cell phone video recorded by Sandra Bland, trooper Brian Insignia could be seen drawing his stun gun and heard saying, "I will light you up if you don't get out of that car now." Later, video showed her limp, lifeless body being drugged from the police car at the police station. And we did nothing. Botham Jean, on September 6th of 2018, was killed by an off-duty Dallas police officer by the name of Amber Geiger, who entered 26-year-old Botham Jean's apartment, she says mistakenly, and she shot and killed him.
Lord, help us.
Even while his apartment was on a completely different floor.
God,
then on March the 13th, my birthday of this year, Breonna Taylor, who just was celebrated on this past weekend, her birthday, was killed, fatally shot by some police officers in Louisville who went erroneously, they say, into her house and killed her. And we're still waiting on charges to be drawn up. Ahmaud Arbery, on February 23rd of this year, an unarmed man jogging down a street was fatally shot in Georgia by a father and son duo of Gregory and Travis McMichael, who trailed him, stalked him, and fatally shot Brother Arbery. And we're waiting on some real charges to come up. And then we have Brother George Floyd. The brutal death of this 46-year-old man who they tried to suggest was trying to pass a counterfeit $20 bill. Folk have tried to insinuate in a nonverbal way in an African-American man's life ain't even worth $20. Our communities are continuing to be riddled with violence in both the hands of criminals and the ones hired and charged to protect us. And up until now, no one was doing anything to stop it. The enemy has done a masterful job of convincing the children of God that we're helpless, that we're hopeless, and that we're useless. But I want to report to somebody on the day, the devil is alive. God didn't make us to be man dependent. The devil is alive. But God called and created us to be strong soldiers in the army of the Lord. In our text today, we witness a period after the death of Joshua. As you know, Joshua represented the next level for the children of Israel. Moses was the deliverer, but Joshua was the conqueror. Moses led Israel out of bondage, but Joshua led Israel into the land of promise. And now we are made aware of the death of this great leader by the name of Joshua. Our text goes on to reveal what occurred as generations came to be that were not witness to the ministry of Joshua. These generations began to be more and more disobedient to God and the directives of God. God said, don't make friends with the enemy, and they became BFFs with enemy nations. God said, don't make peace treaties with the enemy, and they caused summit meetings with them. God said, don't worship the gods of the enemy nations, and they couldn't wait to go to worship services and lift up hands to gods other than the Holy God. And as a result, the favor of God in the lives of the children of Israel began to diminish. I want to pause and just say, if you don't ever protect anything in your life, you need to protect when God has placed favor over your life. You need to make sure that you don't do anything to cancel out that favor. You need to make sure you don't say anything that cancels out that favor. When God shows up and shows out in your life, you ought to give God every bit of energetic praise that you have to thank him for being in your life. But the wonderful thing about God is even in the midst of disobedience, God continues to be faithful. Somebody should have been shouting right there. Somebody out there turned over their kitchen table or their coffee table just to know that even when you keep messing up, God still blesses you. You do know that he woke you up this morning, don't you? You do know that he started you on your way, don't you? You do know that he gave you a portion of health and strength, don't you? You do know that he clothed you in your right mind on this morning. God is still in the blessed business. So before God ruled his people with powerful kings, he delivered them with great judges. Shamgar was the third of these judges. Let's continue to look at what was happening during this time. We've already established that Israel had a bad habit of turning from God. And at this particular time, there was a definite need of deliverance. The people of Israel found themselves completely at the mercy of their enemy, the Philistines. It was so bad, in fact, that if any Israelite succeeded in raising a crop of wheat and harvesting it, that the Philistines would come in and take it right from their hands. The people were in dire need of help because times were just that bad. And an even bigger problem for the Israelites was the problem of discouragement. Somebody ought to be a witness to that on today. They didn't even believe they had a fighting chance. The Philistines had them so convinced of defeat that they even surrendered all their weapons of war. They had even disallowed any blacksmiths to remain in Israel. I want to pause for just a moment and say the enemy would go to all sorts of points to make sure that they try to strip you of every bit of power that you feel you need. They'll give you torn up and missing chapter books so that your education ain't right. They'll make sure that your neighborhoods ain't right. They'll put check cashing stores and liquor stores in your neighborhood, but won't put those same things in there because they're trying to make sure that you don't have everything you need. They are designed systems to where unwed mothers are given more money for not being married and just having a bunch of kids, and the daddies don't need to be in the house. They need to be out of the house. The enemy would go to great lengths and extents to make sure that you don't have everything you need. So just prior to verse 33, it is safe to say that the setting presents us with a people who had no weapons nor the ability even to make any. The morale was gone, and because of that, they felt defeated and they felt hopeless. It's something else when you not only feel defeated, but you feel hopeless. When you feel hopeless, you don't even look for a brighter day. When you feel hopeless, you lose all confidence in yourself. When you feel hopeless, you even lose a measure of faith in God. But the last few words of verse 33 say that Israel was saved.
Thank you.
If I would have ended right there, that's reason enough to shout.
Yes, sir.
Because the text says that deliverance came. I know somebody out there has been wondering, how long must I endure what I'm having to endure? And God is saying deliverance is on the way. Somebody out there said, I'm never going to be at the place that I want to be at my job. And God is saying deliverance is on the way. There's a group of folk that look kind of like me that have been wondering, when will liberation arrive in these United States? And God is saying deliverance is on the way. I know I'm right about it, because never in history has every state in these United States all been on one accord without anybody planning it on one accord. And we all have marches going on in every state. Not only in the United States, but in points around the world. I looked over in England and they were marching. I looked in Italy and they were marching. I looked in Australia and they were marching. Places all over this world have gotten on one accord by the leading and guiding of the Holy Spirit, and change is on the way. The Bible says deliverance came. And this morning we're about to discover that deliverance came from the most unexpected source.
Yes, sir.
I'm going to pause right there and say there was a march on Thursday, I believe, of this week. That march was organized by six teenage girls.
That's ranging
from as young as about 14 and I think maybe going up to 16 or 17. They organized that thing. They put that thing together. They made some flyers and put it out there on Twitter and Instagram. Put it out there on Snapchat and TikTok. And the word got out. And that's the largest march that Nashville has probably ever had, because it came from an unexpected source. Deliverance was about to come from a person that didn't have political clout. He wasn't related to the king. He didn't have a college education. He wasn't a great military leader. Deliverance was about to come from just a plain old ordinary Joe. He wasn't on some special list. He wasn't voted the most likely to succeed by his high school senior graduating class. He wasn't related to some famous individual. God chose Shamgar because he possessed a mindset that made it possible to be used by God in whatever way God wanted to use him. We're going to talk about mindset on today. So let's take a look at this mindset. Understanding it is in these mindsets that one can move from apathy to action.
That's right.
It's these mindsets that can move us from murmuring to moving. It's these mindsets that can move us from fear to faith. It's these mindsets that can move us from being just a witness to being ready to go to war. It's these mindsets that can motivate us to get off of our rusty, dusty, and do something for the Lord. So the first mindset that motivated Shamgar was the fact that Shamgar was fed up. Shamgar was fed up with the way his people were being treated. Shamgar wasn't satisfied with the status quo. He wasn't good with just going along to get along.
Well,
in fact, I believe it made him sick to his stomach to realize that the enemy was bossing him and his people around. He became increasingly fed up every time he heard someone else being overtaken by the enemy.
Yeah.
When he saw his neighbor's wheat being carried off, he was fed up. When he stood at his window and watched his own oxen being driven off, he was fed up. He became more and more fed up with the situations and the circumstances. And because he was fed up, there was hope for him. Understand. It's bad enough to be attacked and beaten up by Satan, but to be content to remain beaten up is even worse. To find yourself living with the pigs is one thing, but to be content to call the pig in your home is another. There must come a time when you are sick and tired of being sick and tired. You won't leave the drugs alone. Until you're fed up with waking up jobless, friendless, and homeless. You won't leave the club alone until you're fed up with waking up with a hangover and a bad reputation.
Woo!
You won't leave gangs alone until you're fed up with living life with your head on a swivel, always worried about a drive-by. You won't really begin to study until you're fed up with flunking test after test. And you won't stand up for yourself and your people until you're fed up with being mistreated and murdered due to racism. Nothing will be done until we're fed up, until we're sick and tired of being sick and tired. And just like Shamgar, you have been literally standing and watching the enemy, the devil, steal your stuff. He's been stealing your property. He's been stealing your family way back from slavery until now. He's been stealing your future. And it appears as if you've been content to just watch him do it. But I declare in this house today, the devil is a lie. Shamgar was fed up, and that made him usable for God's deliverance. It's one thing to be able. But it's another thing to be ready and willing. God wants some folk who are willing to put their lives on the line.
Well,
God wants some folk that are so fed up that they're willing to stand up and say, I might lose some friends, but right is right and wrong is wrong. God wants some folk that are fed up with jobs never giving African Americans the same kinds of opportunities that they give other organizations. Some of the stars of the league, running backs and wide receivers, the league MVP quarterback and Super Bowl winning quarterback who said, time out for the okey-doke. We're fed up, and we want the commissioner of the NFL to say some things. And the next day, the commissioner said those very things. Shamgar was fed up. These football players were fed up. I believe we got some young folk out there on the streets that are fed up. And time is ripe for deliverance to come.
Thank you, Lord.
So the first mindset said that Shamgar possessed was the fact that he was fed up. But not only was he fed up, Shamgar was faithful.
Thank you, Lord.
He was full of faith.
Oh, thank you, Jesus.
He saw the difficulties. He knew the enemy. He realized the weaknesses of the Israelites and the fact that there were no traditional weapons to fight with. But Shamgar saw more than just difficulties. He saw more than just the things that they didn't have. Shamgar saw the forces that bring victory in folks' lives. Shamgar knew the history of his people. Shamgar had heard the stories of how God had time and time again come through and provided for his people. So right in the middle of his predicament, Shamgar possessed the belief that God uses earthly persons to accomplish heavenly tasks.
Yes.
I hope somebody gravitated to that on today.
Yes, he does.
The more he thought about this, the more he knew that God would see him through. We got to understand, even in our own lives, it doesn't take a great person of faith to say, I believe that God uses people. But it does take a great deal of faith to say, I believe that God can use me. And while others were waiting for God to work a miracle, Shamgar trusted God to use him and what he had. And so I'm asking somebody in the house today, what do you have? Shamgar didn't have a spear or a sword, but he did have faith, and it was this faith that made him usable by God. Shamgar was faithful and not fearful and was used by God for deliverance. He was faithful in the face of overwhelming odds. He was faithful in the midst of doubters and haters. He was faithful in the midst of economic depression. He was faithful in the midst of drastic unemployment. He was faithful in the midst of burdensome taxation. He was faithful when everyone else was fearful. And I'm glad that Shamgar was faithful. Because I've learned this effect that fear will paralyze you,
yes,
but faith will push you.
Oh, thank you.
Fear says you can't, but faith says you can.
Yes.
Fear says you better not, but faith says you definitely will.
Yes,
fear says you should not, but faith says you should.
Yes.
Fear says be quiet, but faith says you better speak up.
Yes.
Fear says sit down,
well,
but faith says stand up. Fear says give up, but faith says try one more time.
Woo!
I wonder if I have anybody that's faithful in the house today. Fear says I'm a failure, but faith says I'm more than a conqueror through him that loves us. Fear says I can't do anything, but faith says I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Shamgar was used by God because he was faithful. He was faithful. He was faithful. LeBron James continues to speak about injustices without a care about endorsement because of his faith on the field. Former U.S. Secretary of Defense General James McDonnell Mathis spoke up about the ineptitude and immaturity of President Trump because it was faith on the field. And so Shamgar possessed the necessary mindset because he was fed up. And he was faithful. And finally, we are glad that he had the mindset of being forceful.
Thank you,
All the text says that Shamgar possessed was an ox goad. Let me help you to understand. An ox goad is a 6 to 8 foot long wooden stick with a sharp point on one end and a flat blade on the other. This was used to prod the oxen as one would drive them from place to place. But Shamgar said, it's all I got.
Yeah.
But I'm determined and I'm forceful to make a difference. He knew that things could be better than they were. And thank God Shamgar didn't have the curse of excusing himself from the Lord's service. When the enemy came at him, he He stood his ground.
Oh, yes.
He used what he had and used it in a forceful way. And watch this, y'all. Instead of waiting for a better weapon, instead of saying what he could do if he had more people to help him, instead of him saying what he could do if he were better equipped,
well,
Champ God simply used what he had in his hand, and Champ God took it to the enemy and took it by force. Somebody needs to understand that there are times when we have to be forceful if we're going to accomplish anything for the Lord. Strongholds are conquered by force. Chains are broken by force. Battles are won not by the weak, but they're won by force. When the enemy comes to destroy you, you better get forceful with the enemy and say, not today, buddy. You ain't taking my stuff today, and I'm going to deal with you by force.
Hallelujah.
And look at what the record says. The record says that Shamgar was victorious. He slew 600 well-armed and well-trained Philistines. Shamgar was victorious because he was fed up. The Bible says Shamgar was victorious because he put his faith and it was full in the Lord. And Shamgar was victorious because he was full of force. It's not much, but it's all I've got. The person that surrenders his all to God always wins. You can say, Lord, we sure are hungry. Just give God two fish and five loaves of bread and watch the banquet he'll set out for you.
Yes.
All God wants this morning is for you to put yourself dab smack in the middle of his hands and just say, it's not much, but it's all I've got. Shall God want deliverance for himself and for his people because he was willing to say, it's not much, but it's all I've got. Shall God want through God with only a big stick in his hand, because he was willing to say, it's not much, but it's all I've got. Samson defeated 1,000 Philistines with the jawbone of a donkey, because he was willing to say, it's not much, but it's all I've got. Our beloved David defeated the Philistine giant Goliath with a small smooth stone, because he was willing to say, it's not much, but it's all I've got. And so there may be somebody in the household today that's saying, I hear you talking, Pastor, but what really are you saying? What we're really saying on today is, it's time out for making excuses. It's time out for trying to figure this thing out and just get in the army of the Lord. Just be willing to be used by God in a significant way. And you can just follow the example of not only Shamgar and not only Samson and not even only David, but you can follow the example of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, because Jesus looked down from heaven and was fed up with the sin problem that existed in this world and said, Daddy, I'll get up and go. And Jesus had faith in the Father at the garden when he said, nevertheless, not my will, but thy will be done. And Jesus was forceful when he went to hell and took the keys to both hell and the grave, because Jesus knew, regardless of how much you have, just deal with what you have. And so I want to tell somebody in the house today, Brother Trent, it's time to stand up into the enemy and say, like grandma, knock in your bunk. It's time to stand up to the enemy and say, like A. Paul and MJG, you don't want no drama, drama. It's time to stand up to the enemy and say, like Ludacris, move, enemy. Get out the way. Get out the way. It's not much, but it's all I've got. And whatever God gives me to place in my hand, it might not be much, but it's all I've got. And I've learned over the course of my life that if I present it to the Lord and let the Lord bless and multiply it, that it'll be more than enough, because we serve a God that is a more than enough God. You might not have enough money to meet your monthly obligations, but if you give to God the first fruits of your earnings, God will multiply that thing, and you'll have excess and surplus in your bank account. It ain't much, but it's all you got. Quit running from the enemy. Stand flat-footed and look the enemy in the face and declare unto God, God, it ain't much, but it's all I've got. I ain't running no more. I ain't running scared no more. I'm going to hell or high water. God's going to lift up a standard before me, right in the presence of my enemy. Quit being scared. You might not have much, but what you do have is enough to be used by God. The door of God's church is open to receive you by letter, by Christian experience, but most importantly, to receive you as a member of the kingdom of God. Now, to get that membership level status, you just got to do one thing. Comes really in an A and B part. Confess with your mouth, believe in your heart that Jesus is the Son of God, and that He died for your sins, past, present, and future, and that He's coming back again to redeem His church unto Himself, a church without spot or wrinkle. That's a process, y'all. That's the sanctification process we talked about on Wednesday. But just understand that God wants you, and He loves you so much that He gave His only begotten Son to die for you. That's love, baby.
Yes.
And while you were still a sinner, Jesus died for you. Is there one, as the choir sings, as our music ministry ministers, the door is open, won't you come?
Gracious unto you.